Guys, we're back, and we just want to say start your day off with Muscle Milk. It gives you the boost you need. What are you drinking there, Marshall? You got a Tim Hortons, it looks like.
You know, always Canadian over here, you know?
Tim Hortons. Well, start your day off with a Muscle Milk and a Tim Hortons, not Starbucks. We don't mess with that. We mess with Tim Hortons and Muscle Milk, so yeah.
Speaking of Canadian, rest in peace to Walter Gretzky, who just passed away a couple days ago.
Yeah, sad news.
Tough, especially for like us local Southwestern Ontarioans. You know, he's kind of like a big deal around here.
Ontarioans.
Ontarioites, Ontarians, whatever it is.
Whatever you want to call it. All right, but we did have some boxing this weekend. I can't believe we didn't recap it last week. It was a huge fight. We didn't preview it. Clarissa Shields taking on the Canadian. What's her name again?
Marie-Eve Decaire.
And she was the Canadian who was an IBF champion, if I'm right?
I thought she was WBO. She had one of the belts. She had one of the four belts.
One of the four belts. That sounds horrible for a weight class. Damn boxing. But I see the highlights of the fight, and Clarissa Shields is dominated.
Yeah, I honestly didn't even catch the highlights, but Decaire looked a little beaten up. She was 34, 35, kind of older, undefeated, though. Clarissa was coming down in weight. So, if you know, Clarissa, after the Olympics, went pro at 168, won a title there. Then she went down to 160 and became undisputed and had her biggest fight to date against Christina Hamer. And then she moved down again to 154, and now she's become undisputed again. So, she's the fastest boxer in the four-weight division to become undisputed twice. It's pretty cool.
First, right?
Yeah, I believe she's the first as well, yeah.
I just want to say, on Clarissa Shields, this is like an Amanda Nunes, Clarissa Shields. I'm just using them as two examples that you want to think of. Okay, so you look at someone's resume, right? You go off the names they beat all the time.
Yep. Yep.
When you look at Clarissa Shields, she's beating good people. People just don't know the names. So a lot of times, like even in Demetrius Johnson's case, people don't know the people they're fighting, but doesn't mean they're not great fighters. You know what I mean? Like, they are good wins. Only diehards know these fighters as good fighters and good wins. It's just that they're not known, and I think people get that mixed up a lot of the time.
100%. And the crazy thing is right now, we're living through a point in history where we have potentially the two greatest female fighters of all time at the peak of their powers in the same area. It's crazy. Yeah,
for sure, for sure.
We were talking about the other day, we're like, based on accomplishments, there's an argument to say that Clarissa is the greatest combat sports athlete in women's history. But then when you look at a resume, like you said, you have to go with Nunes because the resumes are not equivalent.
Exactly. And it's sad because, like, Clarissa Shields is still beating undefeated fighters. I think the girl she just beat had, like, a 17-0 or 20-0. So they're not bad fighters. They just don't have that name power.
And now there's talk of her going down to welterweight, so going down another weight division and taking on undefeated, pound-for-pound, one of the best women fighters in the world, Katie Taylor.
We just don't know.
Katie Taylor's pretty big over in the UK, but over here she's not so big.
That's what I mean. Like, this, in women's fighting and boxing is definitely not at the level of MMA. Like, for eyes, not level of competition, just eyes.
Right. So this is what I was saying to my dad and my brother yesterday. Why doesn't, instead of Clarissa being so focused on having her own card, because she's so determined, she wants to have her own pay-per-views, her own cards, which she just did on Friday. I'm sure it didn't sell very well. Why don't you fight on as a co-main event or a featured belt on a Joshua card, a Canelo card? Get your name up. You look at like the Valentina Shevchenkos, the Amanda Nunes's.
Yeah.
Most of the time they're co-main eventing and they're making big money, bringing big audiences.
Now Nunes could probably do a pay-per-view on her own. I would watch a pay-per-view Nunes on her own. But
yes.
I think he has. But that's what Clarissa Shields needs, is to bump her stardom up.
I think the PFL move is going to do a lot for her. I think that's going to bring a lot of eyeballs to her as well. So let's see what happens going forward.
Absolutely. It could also destroy her.
We could be eating our words in a few months. I think she's having her first fight in April, too.
We'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
All right. Then we got the big card of the weekend. You're pretty happy. I mean, you made a couple bucks, so he's a happy man, smiling. He's laughing at everyone, but let's get right to it. I'm going to start off with the Tim Elliott fight.
Yeah, man.
I'm not going to say too much, but I'm glad he's on a two-fight win streak. The man could make moves at flyweight. He's awkward.
Yeah, did you see what the little viral clip he had when he was on top of the guy mauling him? He started yelling at him.
Yeah, because so there's some things saying that someone sent pictures of, I forget, the Espinoza, yeah. I guess, beating up a woman or his girlfriend, and he was beating him up for that.
So this is all allegedly. We don't know any details on this.
But we don't know anything yet.
Tim Elliott was on top of him mauling him and was yelling, "Oh, you like beating women, huh? You're a woman beater." Like, dude, that is some, that is extreme. That's violent.
That's nice to see, though.
Yeah, if it's true, good, good.
And then we got, did you see the Kai Car France fight?
I saw the first round, but I missed what happened. I missed the finish.
Yeah, it was the first round. I guess he got beat up, like, up to a 10-8 round, and he came back and knocked him out.
See, I saw him get taken down, and I figured it was just going to be a rinse and repeat, and I had to head over to my dad's for the rest of the card, so I just left at that point. But, yeah, somehow he pulled it out. So, shout out to Kai Kara France. We both picked Rogério Bonneton, so.
For sure. And then we both have, then we had, I think, Song Yadong.
Yeah. Three times. No, Joseph Benavides, Askar Askarov was first.
Yeah, Benavides might have to hang it up.
In the post-fight press conference, Dana said he's not concerned with Benavides yet because he said he's still putting up, like, decent performance. He's not getting straight beat. But he was the number two guy coming into this. I don't know what they do with him now.
Yeah, he's pretty. He fell off. It's crazy. Maybe Kai Car France.
Maybe Kai Carver, yeah. If Manel Cape wins this weekend, maybe Cape versus Benavides.
That'd be good, too, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, Song Yadong was on riding a 9-fight undefeated streak, 8-0-1, and took on the Matrix Kyler Phillips, who I was crazily impressed with.
Yeah, he looked really good. He's definitely a contender at a bantamweight. He made Song Yadong look, I guess, human more. I did not think he was going to win that fight, and it's good to see another contender come out.
Yeah, man. And did you see the right hand he landed in the first round on Yadong's face? Yeah,
or the spinning back kick?
Dude, he was pulling some shots up. And so he's 9-1. Yadong's now 16-5, but he's 8-0-1 in his last fight. Yeah. 8-1-1. Both of these guys have futures, and they're both under 25 years old.
Yeah, Song's only like 23, so we got some time with him.
Right, right. Continuing on in the bantamweight division, the first fight that I won a little bit of coin on, my man Dominic the Dominator Cruz taking on Casey Kenny.
It was a lot closer, I think, than people made it out to be. It was split, though, right?
Yeah, but it was a weird split because you had one judge giving it 30-27.
Yeah,
it was weird. And then 29-28 for Kenny, another judge.
I did think Cruz won, but I would have been happy either way, honestly. I thought it was pretty close.
I thought the only round that you possibly could have scored for Kenny was the second.
The second round, yeah.
But I thought Dominic won all of them, but they were all fairly competitive rounds. But I thought Cruz edged them all.
Yeah, yeah. But from what I was seeing for people online, they made it seem like it was a sweep, like it was dominating by Dominic. And I didn't think it was dominant.
Yeah, he looked a little slow. His footwork wasn't as fast as it used to be. But
his movement, his head movement and stuff, he looked like he was aging a bit, but it could be ring rust, which he doesn't believe in, but I think he's just been needing to get his feet wet.
I worry about his durability, though, because he was outlanding Kenny and landing the bigger shots throughout the fight, and he was the one that was more marked up at the end.
That could just be us white men. You don't know this, but us white men, they damage up a little bit more than other cultures, I find.
You know Dominic Cruz is Mexican, right?
Is he?
His name's Cruz, bro.
Oh, my God. Okay, guys, we're gonna edit that out. We're definitely gonna edit that out.
Anyway, we'll just roll on from that one, and we'll continue on into the main card. We had what do we have next? Thiago Santos taking on Alexander Rakic, and what was not a good fight at all.
It was horrible, and no one was shot the gun. I would be surprised if they honestly let Thiago Santos go. He's damaged goods.
He is damaged goods, but I didn't think he lost the fight.
I did.
If anything, I thought it was a draw. The first round, I thought it was 10-10. I didn't know how to score. Neither did anything. Second round was definitely Rakic. Third round was definitely Thiago. I don't know how. It was a weird fight.
Yeah, I could see a draw, but I just think they're both didn't look impressive. Rakic was talking about Joe Rogan looked pissed off at the interview. It was hilarious, but about the fight because he was bored. And that's another subject we're going to get on. But I just think that Rakic was calling for a title shot is crazy.
Oh, yeah, it doesn't even make sense. What you so Thiago now is on a 3-fight losing streak. He was coming into the division ranked number 2 in a fairly light UFC light heavyweight division.
Yeah.
What do you think they're going to get rid of him?
They let go of Overeem, so it wouldn't surprise me.
If they let, yeah, I think
people don't realize about Overeem, though, is that Overeem was making a huge coin from the UFC. That's a big part of it.
That's my point. Like, Overeem was making $800,000 a fight. Thiago's probably not even making half of it.
Yeah, so I don't know. We'll see. We'll see how it goes. I mean, the light heavyweight division is thin. Like you said, they need names. And Bellator is heating up, and they can use Thiago too. So that'd be interesting. Can you imagine Anthony Rumble versus Thiago Santos?
Or Yoel Romero even? But honestly, I think what they're going to do with him is you might see the loser of Lionheart versus Crew.
That's what I was thinking.
But he fought Lionheart at middleweight, I believe.
I would like to see him fight Devin Clark.
They've never fought before?
No.
That's a decent match. Devin Clark's a bit of a grappler, though, isn't he?
Yeah.
Fancies himself a grappler. Yeah, so that's a tough fight for Thiago. We've seen his grappling deficiencies.
Yes. But anyway, let's get on to...
Islam.
I don't even want to talk about this dude too much. I just don't like him. I mean, I don't get why. I'm just sick of the same style. It's just so. It's you're good, but like, I don't know.
Here's my thing with Makhachev. He's getting touted as the next Khabib. Khabib's in his corner. He's got the same beard as Khabib. It's like, dude, you're not Khabib.
No.
Khabib finishes people. Khabib has a killer instinct. Islam held him on the ground for 2.5 rounds. And did almost zero damage. And then finally goes for submission halfway through the third fight. Through the third round. You could have finished him in the first round, man.
Yeah. He's not. I don't know, man. I just think he's. I think he'd have problems with the top guys. I mean, let's be honest. He got knocked out by Adriano Martins back in the day. Yeah. But really, since then, has he fought any names? Like, Drew Dober is not a killer to me.
Well,
he's
Drew Dober
a good fighter, but he's not a great fighter.
Drew Dober wasn't even ranked.
That's what I mean. He hasn't fought anyone name-wise.
Yeah, I mean, I think Islam was 13 or 12 coming into this, so maybe you move him up one spot. I can't see him taking Paul Felder's 10th spot. I can't see that.
I would love that RDA fight. I think RDA poses problems for him.
Oh, 100% RDA poses some problems for him. RDA is not going to just get taken down like that. Where's Drew Dober's takedown defense? Your two main training partners are Kamaru Usman and Justin Gaethje. What are you doing?
Yeah, it's sad. I don't know. I don't know what you do. They're saying Tony Ferguson, but I don't think he deserves that fight yet.
No. What? Tony Ferguson, at the very least, is still a star. He deserves to be fighting other star-like fighters.
Yeah, for sure. I agree with that.
So anyway, we'll roll on to the weirdest fight maybe of the last, I don't even know, 10 years. Peter Yan, Aljamain Sterling.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly had the first round 10-10, and then the other two I had Peter Yan, but it looked like it was going to be, I thought if the fight was going to go any longer, I thought he was going to get stopped the fifth, Aljamain. He was taking shots, he was getting sloppy, he was gassed.
I had every round for Yan. The fourth round looked like Yan was getting close to a finish, and then out of nowhere, Mr. No Mercy lives up to his name. Like I've been said all last week, this dude is mean and throws the most illegal shot I've ever seen in my life.
Like, if you didn't want to talk to anyone in an interview, I wouldn't want to talk to Peter Yan. The guy just seems like he'd be a dick. Tell me if I'm wrong.
Maybe, but I might just be a language barrier.
That could be true. But the guy's raising his hand at the bell?
Yeah, no. But here's my thing. So, there's a couple takeaways from this. The decision was done properly. The fight should not have continued. But there shouldn't have been any hesitation. It just should have been DQ right there at the...
It should have been stopped.
But, there's a big but here. Aljamain Sterling, man, show some cojones. I'm going to get canceled. I'm going to get hated on for this. You can't go out like that, bro. You can't be flipping around the octagon. Just take it on the chin and just sit there and accept what happened.
End of the day is... People, to me, this is how I look at it. You get kneed in the fight in a fight. Are you going to jump around for 2 minutes or are you going to keep fighting? You know what I mean? Right. Like, it was a big knee, but, like, I don't know. I just feel like they get up faster. If he knocked him out with that knee, he would have got up faster even after being knocked out.
People are going to say, oh, you guys have never fought. You guys have never done this. I've been severely concussed many times in my life, and I've never flailed on the ground like I was a fish. Ever. Never. You not fought. Even close. I know that, but I'm not trying to, like, I'm not trying to brag with what I did. All I'm saying is I've been severely concussed multiple times. Believe it at that. I've never in my life flailed on the ground like I'm some fish out of water.
Yeah, it was crazy. You obviously got to run it back. I mean, I think Peter Yan gets his belt back. It holds up Sanhagen versus Dillashaw. I actually like it because now we got Sanhagen versus Dillashaw, which is great.
Poor Sanhagen. He's got to go through another killer to get to a title shot. He's the biggest loser of 259, and he didn't even fight.
Yeah, I know. It's sad.
It's so tough, man. And I was listening to Chael Sonnen, and he made a good point. TJ Dillashaw cheats, and he gets a 2-year suspension, right?
Yeah.
Peter Yan cheats, and he gets an automatic title fight.
Isn't that what I said to you?
Yes.
I don't agree that Peter Yan should get a title shot right away.
Okay, let's say they don't do a title shot. Then what do you do?
I would like to see Aljamain versus Sanhagen again.
And then you go TJ versus Yan?
Yes.
I think that makes more sense. I like that better.
For sure. Let's see what people say.
Yeah. Okay. One that we could not have been any more wrong with. Amanda Nunes taking on Megan Anderson and basically stealing her soul in the process.
Holy, that right hand. It was a right?
Yeah.
Over the top. Oh, my God. A stanky leg. Those long legs looked good shaking, though.
I didn't think that Amanda was going to have a speed advantage. I don't know. Maybe I was, like, delusional or something. I thought Megan was faster than that.
The booty gets in your way and you get all, like, fluttered, you know?
I was shocked, man. The hand speed that Nunes showed was very impressive. It's like, you look at Nunes and she's got, like, a little bit soft of a midsection.
Yeah.
And it's
like, you don't expect... At featherweight, because she said she has force weight on.
Right. At featherweight. It's like, you don't expect these kind of performances, and she keeps doing it.
Yeah, it's crazy. And honestly, it was perfect. She just seems like an all-around good person, too. Like, shout out to her family. She's a really cute kid. She looked happy in there.
Yeah, she looked awesome. It's one of the best performances she's ever done. I don't know what you do with her. She's only 32 years young. She's taken almost no damage in her UFC run. I don't know what you do with her.
I honestly think she's levels above. People are going to hate on me for this. But, like, seeing Nunes, I think she's even levels above Valentina now.
Really?
Yes.
I disagree, but we'll have to see. Valentina's got a big fight coming against Andrade.
I think she dismantles Shevchenko third time around.
Two fights, sir. The first and second one.
Well, what was the question?
How did you score the Valentina Nunes fights?
2-1 and 3-2 for Nunes.
Okay, the first one I had 2-1 for Nunes, and then I had a 3-2 Shevchenko in the second one.
But it was close, so.
Yeah, not a robbery either way. But no. I think you have to dismantle.
Look at her face. I have no damage. Look at her face.
I think they have to get rid of the featherweight division, man. There's nothing there.
It's not going to happen. Dana White says as long as she's there, she wants to fight, it's going to keep happening. If the girl who beats Felicia Spencer, who's 1-0, she'll get the next title shot.
If that fight happens, I hope Nunes stands with her. That woman, Wolf, or whatever woman's name, she's like a 2-time U.S. boxing champion. She's got some pedigree behind her hands. I'd like to see their stand with Nunes, see what happens.
Wow.
But the fight to make, obviously the Cyborg fight, it's too bad we can't see that rematch. I don't think it goes any other way. I think Cyborg gets knocked out again. But Kayla Harrison has got two fights left on her PFL contract.
Yeah, it would be nice to see her go over and make the weight.
Yeah, she made 145 when she fought in Invicta a few months ago, so she can do it.
For sure. I think a Holly Holm rematch at featherweight, make it a different weight class.
Yeah.
To treat some people.
I like that, but Holly Holm just pulled out of her fight with Julia Penne. Yeah.
And Dana White said that Penne is probably next for the bantamweight title.
Like, I don't want to see that, man. I have no interest.
Like, what does she do to Penne?
Probably worse than Megan Anderson.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know. We have to find something. Maybe 2 years from now when Clarissa Shields is done something in the PFL and her contract's up, maybe we see a 34-year-old Nunes take on a 27-year-old T-Rex Shields. I'm okay with that, but, like, there's nothing right now. There's nothing.
I know. I agree.
Okay. Jan Blachowicz, Senor Polish Power, took on Israel, the last style bender, Adesanya, and he took his O.
He took his O. It had to go. 20-1. Can you believe that?
He's 20 and Polish Power.
That's crazy.
Dude, the run this man has been on is insane. And he was underdog in 8 of his last 9 fights.
Insane. I didn't actually see him winning this fight. I was at my buddy's house, Derek, and Derek always watched our show. And he went for the takedown in the 5th round. When he got the takedown in the 5th round, I screamed. I'm like, yes, Izzy's done.
Dude, so, did I not call it? Did I not pick it?
Yeah, it's crazy.
Brought a little coin over my way. I should have, but I don't know. I like doing little fun bets. If I bet big and I win big, that's cool. But if I bet big and I lose, then I'm like, fuck.
Yeah, it sucks. Beep. Yeah, Jan looked great. I would like to see him fight Glover next. Izzy, it's sad because we were talking about this last night too, that doesn't take a lot of steam off his pipe.
Yes, it definitely does.
Okay, so where do you see him now? Do you see him falling out? Okay, I'm going to actually say this. When Conor McGregor was ranked number 2, I think, pound for pound in the world, when he beat Aldo, or number 3 or whatever, he lost to Nate Diaz. He dropped to, like, number 9.
Okay.
Do you see him, which Nate Diaz didn't go pound for pound, which doesn't make sense, but do you see him dropping to around 10?
Not 10, but Jan's definitely going to be above him.
I don't think so.
You think that Izzy still going to be ahead of Jan in pound for pound?
I will put anyone on watching this channel, I agree that Jan should be ahead of him. I will make a bet that Jan is below Israel on Tuesday.
Okay, hold on. Remember when Lomachenko...
This is UFC rankings we're talking about.
Okay, but remember when Teofimo Lopez fought Lomachenko?
The boxing rankings are better, though.
And Teofimo was not even in the top 20, and now he's ahead of Lomachenko in the pound-for-pound rankings.
Yeah, that's how it should be.
You can't. You cannot put Israel Adesanya ahead of Jan. If the UFC does that, it's a joke.
$10?
No, I don't want to take that bet. Dana White still has Khabib as a champion, so I can't take that bet.
Watch. And you're going to post it on your page. That Brady, and then why you say headlines, Brady was right. Deal?
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine. That's a shame. So you and I are both in agreement. Jan Blachowicz is ahead of Izzy in our pound-for-pound record.
Oh, sure.
Okay, good.
The bigger, stronger man, but his striking actually looked really good.
Dude, the commentary was terrible. Jan was
it was pissing me off. I wanted to get to that too. Like, Joe Rogan, you go away. Daniel Cormier, go away. You're biased.
Jan was outstriking Izzy after the first 2 rounds, and they're DC goes, Izzy's hitting him with whatever he wants.
I know. The striking was the commentary destroyed me.
How did you score the fight?
I had it 4-1.
That's what I had. I gave Izzy the first round. The second round, I gave the Jan. The third round was close, but I thought Jan did more damage, so I gave him that. And then the 4 and 5, he wrestled them.
In data, it was like, people are crazy who think it's 4-1. No. He doesn't struck him for 2 rounds.
I think you can have anywhere from 2-2-1, a tie, to 4-1. Those are anywhere in that is a reasonable scorecard.
Oh, the 49-45 was kind of crazy, though.
49-40. Isn't that 4 rounds to 1?
No, they did a 10-8
for you. Oh, yeah. There was no 10-8 rounds. Doesn't make sense.
Which they're getting crazy with giving away 10-8s, which is insane.
So we got Jan versus Glover next. How do you see that going out right now off the top of your head?
I think Jan knocks him out.
Yeah, it's not a good fight for Glover. It's a tough fight. And that's some 2 old men going at it.
For the belt. Jan knocks him out. Polish Power.
He goes down and he will take on either the winner. Oh, go ahead.
King of the middleweights.
Oh, 100% king of the middleweights.
It's hilarious.
He might as well be champ. Just give him that belt right now.
I know. Insane.
But Izzy goes down. Would you rather see him fight the winner of Vettori Till or Costa Whitaker?
Till.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're right.
But the middleweight division had life because of Izzy. It kind of died off a bit.
Yeah.
When a champion when a champion gets beat in that status of champ trying to go for it, it's hard to sell. It doesn't matter how you went up.
How good is Gegard Mousasi? That's all I want to say.
Oh, gosh.
Okay.
How good is Rafael Lovato Jr.?
Oh, my. That's a mythical fighter. He's one of those guys. It's like one of those big what-ifs. Like, if Khamzat doesn't come back, Khamzat and Lovato are the two biggest what-ifs in MMA history.
For sure.
Yeah. So, we're rolling on. We got some fights for you this weekend.
Biggest? Yeah. Did you say, like, biggest?
Yeah, whatever.
You said Khamzat is the biggest?
What are you talking about?
Never mind.
What did you think about this weekend's UFC card?
It was good.
Looking at the undercards, not much on the undercard. Zubair Tugagov is coming back. Nazareth Hasparas taking on Don Madge. Hasparas has been on a bit of a tough go.
That's Kelvin Gastelum, right?
That's Kelvin Gastelum, yeah.
All right. Well, let's see if he gets it back. But
Eric Anders versus Darren Stewart. That's a fun fight at middleweight.
Ah, man. I think Darren Stewart. I don't know, man. I go back and forth with this fight. It should be a striking fight. Darren might mix in some clinch work and stuff. I think Darren Stewart edges it out.
I think Darren Stewart's going to stop him.
Really?
Yeah. He looked good against Holland.
And, yeah, I think he won that fight. And yeah. Darren Stewart is, he could stop him. I mean, it's kind of payback for Eric Anders blowing us off.
Yeah, true. Shout out to the dentist. Maybe you want, if you hear the Stewart, come on our show, bro, anytime. Manel Cape is coming back in a quick turnaround against
I didn't even know that fight was booked. It must have just been booked.
Yeah, when you told me, I was surprised. Against Mateus Nicolau. I don't know anything about Nicolau.
He was in the UFC a while ago. I think actually 2019. He had a loss. He got cut. He signed with an organization, won two fights, and he's back. It's a fight, in my opinion, that as long as he's not hesitant and actually fights, Manel Cape should stop him. I'd say second round TKO.
Dude, if he loses this fight in similar fashion to the first one, we're looking at a Will Brooks type situation.
Horrible.
Like, I was very high on Will Brooks coming over. We both are very high on Manel Cape coming over. He's got to get a win here.
He's got to. I think he does.
Yeah, I agree. Angela Hill, Ashley Yoder got rebooked for this card.
It'll be a decision.
Yeah, we both think Angela Hill is going to kind of edge that one out. Dan Ige, Gavin Tucker might be fight of the card.
I'm so excited for this fight.
I didn't even know that was on this card. I thought that was further off. This is a beautiful fight.
It was supposed to be Cub Swanson versus Gavin Tucker, I think, and then they made it Dan Ige instead. I think Gavin Tucker at 34 finally comes into the top 15.
Yeah, he's a little bit bigger than him. He throws his shots a little bit better, but Dan Ige is tough, man. He's going to be there. I don't see Tucker stopping him.
Yeah, unless he puts the pressure so much on Tucker that Tucker folds and then he gets stopped. I could see that happening. But Tucker's looked amazing since his loss to Rick Glenn. But, man, we got to go for the Canadian. I think he just edges out with footwork. He's able to avoid that onslaught because he has great footwork, great boxing. I think he'll be able to move out of the way and just keep it up for three rounds. I think if it was a five-round fight, it would definitely favor Dan Ige.
Mm. Shout out to another guy that blew us off, Gavin Tucker. Let's get it done. Ben Rothwell is taking on Felipe Lins in what's going to be a sloppy, sloppy heavyweight fight.
But I love when Ben Rothwell wins because his interviews are priceless. So I always want Ben Rothwell to win.
I think he could stop Lins.
Yeah, I think he stops him in the second round. And Ben Rothwell's going to be there for a long time. He used to be a top 10 guy. You wouldn't believe it. And then he got suspended. Be Josh Barnett and stuff. But he will. What were you saying?
Remember he beat Overeem?
Oh, yeah, he did beat Overeem. But I think it is going to be sloppy. I mean, Ben Rothwell fights. He doesn't look good ever when he boxes, does he?
No, it's terrible, but it's effective.
So, and he's awkward. I remember when he fought Brandon Barry, he did a dance and shit. And Brandon Barry was like, what the hell's going on? He got knocked out.
Co-main event, we have Misha Serkinov. I didn't know he was still in the UFC. Another Canadian. taking on Ryan Spann. That's a tough fight for Serkinov.
Oh, man, the height difference?
Yeah, it's going to be tough.
Spann's actually really good on the ground, though. He's more of a grounds fighter.
I think Spann's going to knock out Serkinov.
Really?
Yeah.
I think Serkinov, I don't know. Yeah, I'd have to agree with you. I think Spann knocks him out. Again, second round, I just think he's just, the height and size is going to be a huge difference in that fight.
Spann looked really good against in his Walker. Last fight against Walker, yeah, and then it kind of just fell apart, but he showed some skills.
Yeah, but Walker's chin's horrible, so.
Yeah. Bilal Muhammad steps up on short notice after just being Diego Lima to take on Leon Edwards. An interesting fact is they're both 18-3 coming into this fight.
That is interesting. I think, isn't Leon Edwards, you said 8-8 wins?
He's on an 8-fight win streak, yeah.
That's insane, eh? Kind of, he's getting into that Tony Ferguson zone if he wins.
Third most fights in UFC welterweight history.
Wow. And it sucks because he lost to Kamaru already, so it's hard to really make that fight. I think that's one of the reasons why they haven't made that fight is because it's a rematch.
Yeah, it's also he's not marketable. He's horrible on social media. Like, you have Colby Covington, Gilbert Burns, Usman, Masvidal, all the even Wonderboy Thompson as of late. All these guys have been vocal going at it.
Yeah.
And Leon does nothing.
Except cry.
But, I mean, Leon's a very good fighter. If he doesn't win this fight, I'd be shocked, especially because Bilal's coming on short notice. I think Leon, unanimous decision.
Oh, it's going to be a 50. I give Bilal probably the first round. I think it's going to shock you a little bit. It's going to prove that he should be there. Like, this is going to be a fight where Muhammad is going to be there. He's not going to win the fight, but he's going to show with, like, Muhammad has good footwork, good wrestling. Like, he's really well-rounded. Now, the thing is, Leon Edwards is really well-rounded everywhere, too. But he's just better everywhere.
Yep.
So, I just think Leon Edwards is the better fighter.
And Bilal Muhammad's pace is, it's hectic.
It is hectic. So, I mean, the later rounds could affect Leon, too.
Let's just go ahead.
The cardio is really good for both fighters.
Right, right. Devil's advocate, Bilal Muhammad comes in, pulls off an upset. What do you do with him?
Ooh, Stephen Thompson.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Quick out of the mouth right there. So,
so that's what we got for you this week for the UFC. we have a pretty good boxing match. Actually, I know a very good. My bad. It's actually a very good high level boxing.
Former pound for pound.
Yes, and so we have. Roman Chocolatito Gonzalez, the former number one pound-for-pound fighter in the world, taking on Juan Francisco Estrada in a rematch that is 9 years later.
Now, let's tell people that this is dwarf fighting, so they know. So tune in. If you want to see two midgets go at it, it might be a great fight for you.
Your first fight in 2012 was at junior flyweight. I think that's like 110 pounds. I'm not sure. This one's at super flyweight, so maybe like 6 pounds higher. I'm not sure what the weight class is, but it's on DAZN. The first fight was a war. This is going to be another war. I think Chocolatito's going to get it done, but they're both fringe pound-for-pound guys today, so it's going to be a good fight.
Chocolatito should get a unanimous decision.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think it'll be a knockout. They're too, they don't hit hard enough.
But. That's the problem. They don't hit hard. They just can take whatever. It's like smashing a midget, like, let's say.
You're a savage. Anything else you want to add? You want to talk about Dan Hardy at all?
Yeah, let's talk about Dan Hardy. What are your thoughts on that?
I mean, here's my thing. We don't know a lot of the details. Apparently, he had allegedly had some kind of altercation with a woman on Fight Island. I don't want a man getting fired for potential. Like, there better be evidence of something substantial. I don't want just woke culture making someone lose their job again.
That's the thing with this world nowadays. And I'm just saying, this is just a story about it. I was watching The Ranch. I don't know if you know that show on Netflix.
Yep.
And the guy who's on the 70s show, he had rape charges or whatever against him. Like, at first they were alleged, and he lost his job, got taken off the show. I think they did prove it right that it happened. I don't know if you know what I'm talking about, the curly-haired guy on the 70s show. But you can't allegedly do that to someone and take away their job. Because, like, if I work at a pizza, and someone says this guy raped me, you're automatically fired, even though what? They just walked in and said that they don't even know that person.
It's not right. It's like court of public opinion is now the court of law. It doesn't make any sense.
Yes. So you need to, like, all I'm saying is you need to prove someone. Like, we need something. You can't just say, and no offense, like, you can't just say and take away someone's life.
Yeah, and so someone was saying, does this end his potential of coming back as a fighter in the UFC? So the thing is, I'm pretty sure his contract as a fighter is completely different than his contract as an analyst. But because of optics, the UFC is not going to give him a fight while this is going through courts and being dealt with.
Exactly. I mean, I could see him signing with somewhere in Japan.
If the UFC lets him fight, but he's under contract by the UFC.
They'll let him go.
I don't know. I want him to fight. He's been training. He's getting ready. It's been like 2 or 3 years of getting ready for this. He should fight right now. I hope the UFC lets him go and fight.
I hope so, too.
But that's all I got for you. Anything else you want to add?
No, it's a good weekend. Good weekend of fights. This one's going to be pretty sweet.
Yeah. We'll be back next week with a bunch of more stuff for you. Stay tuned.
Peace.